We're on.
It's all natural. Yeah. You know, actually, what I want to do is, I want to.
All right, relax, relax, dog. What I want to do, actually, I thought this would be kind of fun, is I want you two, because I know we could just start this, but I want you two to steel-man each other's arguments.
To what?
It's called steel-manning your arguments. So basically, what you're going to do, or what you're both going to do, is you're going to describe each other's positions and the reasons for those positions, like the reason someone would think that way, to the point where a person that you think they would agree with it. So if I'm you, and I would say, so Chad, you believe global warming, like this is your position on global warming. I think the reasons you believe global warming are X, Y, Z. And what are you, like, how correct was I in doing that?
All right. So because you want to give it a shot?
The purpose for doing this is that so that we're not having arguments with straw men. We're not having arguments with people who are here, and we're not talking about ideas and things that aren't like on the table, you know. So that we're, you know, whatever he's criticizing, I want it to be something that like, yes, like that is what I believe. Or it's like, because a lot of times with these arguments, it's like you just have a caricature of what the other person says or is. So I want to clarify exactly where we stand, what we believe.
Mainly, what I would intend to do, part of this, is to talk about what is science and what is not science.
Well, we can get to that. But I think
I'll start.
Yeah.
This is how, okay. All right, to me, I'm not surprised that everybody in your age and your generation, that the vast majority would believe in this. You've been subjected to it your whole lives. Because really, the whole global warming thing started, the real push started around 1988, all right, and with James Hansen and Al Gore. It wasn't Al Gore, but James Hansen testified before Congress, James Hansen being the head of, I think, NASA's climate unit. And what they did ahead of time was they disabled the air conditioning. And they did this in the middle of July, the hottest week in Washington, D.C., which is very hot anyway. Mm-hmm. So they disable the air conditioning, and he gives us, and everybody's sweating in there from this hearing. And he's talking about how by the end of the century, we're not going to be here anymore. And that was, you're talking 1988, so that was, 12 years away. Mm-hmm. And so, that was really the start of the push. I remember when that happened. Okay, so and at that time you're being subjected to cartoons like Captain Planet, because Ted Turner, TBS, was a big global warming guy or environmentalist too, or self-described, I should say. So I'm seeing this stuff on TV. So you've been hammered with this your whole life. You probably don't remember. You may not remember a lot of it, but
I remember Captain Planet.
Yeah. Right. Well, that was that was part of that. That came out then. We used to laugh about it at the time.
Yeah.
And this bunch of environmental weenies pushing this stuff.
We prefer green weenies.
Yeah, right. Because most of them are not, And then another thing I can remember is the fall of Eastern Europe, the Iron Curtain, all the Soviet bloc countries when they all got their freedom from the Soviet Union, that was gone probably before you were even aware of it. There was the evil empire. And I remember an interview with the new president of Czechoslovakia, and the interviewer asked him, the communists, they're gone. He goes, they didn't just disappear, did they? And the guy's answer was no. He said they're now in the environmental movement. He called them, that's the first time I heard the term watermelons. He says they're green on the outside but red on the inside. And it was it was not an accident that the first Earth Day was on Vladimir Lenin's birthday. I don't remember what year it was, but those people, and was it the degrowth, no growth movement?
Degrowth movement.
I'm interested in learning.
That's something you need to look up.
Okay.
And because, it's from Europe, and most this environmentalism stuff is all really came over from Europe. It started over there.
Okay. All right. But so
the degrowth movement, you got a sample of it when that, AOC, came out with that ridiculous green thing, right? That was almost out of their manifesto, the degrowth movement.
Specifically, like in a sentence, what is the degrowth movement?
To deindustrialize the Western world. Mm-hmm. You could sum it up to that. And impose communism. And okay. you know, really, in a nutshell, you read all that, and that's what it was. And that's the communist movement has been trying to deindustrialize the United States as long as my entire lifetime.
Okay.
So this is just, a continuation of that.
And so I guess to sum this up.
Now, you want me to start on? So you're subjective. One thing I left out. I go off on a tangent, but I left out. You're bombarded with media stuff about all this too. About global warming. Every year is hotter than the last. I'll get into the science stuff later. But that's why you would believe. I can see why you believe. You're bombarded with it every day. It's in the media. There's articles on global warming is causing this, global warming is causing that, and there was a guy that he gave up on it because it became too overwhelming. But he used to document all the things in the news that global warming caused, and he was up around 800 things, and it would be like too much rain, not enough rain, too much snow. Of course, the obvious ones, but I was hearing for years and years that we were never going to see snow, and for a while in the late 90s. When it was kind of warm, like Virginia, Washington, D.C., even up as far as Long Island, it hardly snowed there at all. And they were all talking, well, these kids are going to grow up, never know what snow is. Well, coming this, the 21st century, they're bombarded with snow. They've got hammered many, many times. So, and then all of a sudden it changes that, global warming causes snow, too. So when I get into the science part later, I'll address that.
So, okay, so basic idea. I think
that's why you would believe in global warming.
Okay. So, your turn.
10 years earlier, you would have believed in global. If you were born, say, in 69, 68 or 60, you a good chance you might have believed in global cooling.
Well, actually the epoch that we're supposed to be in, if you look at the orbit of the planet to the sun, we're actually in a cooling period.
Some people believe we're gonna.
We were in that trajectory prior to industrialization.
Yeah, actually, I remember reading stuff. So
go ahead.
Yeah.
All right. So straw man.
No. We're steel manning.
Steel manning.
Straw man is you
straw man.
Yeah. Take on arguments of people that aren't there, that don't exist.
Okay.
That people aren't arguments that people aren't making. So what do you think? Like,
why does he not believe? What actually is your position? Like, is global warming happening regardless of the industrial influence? It's not happening.
Not catastrophic. I mean, I would say we've been in a warming trend since the end of the Little Ice Age,
which is was
sort of the end of the Revolutionary War.
Okay.
Back when if you remember your history from there, do you remember when Washington marched on Trenton on Christmas Eve, Christmas Day?
I missed that story.
And the river was almost frozen.
Yeah.
Big blocks of ice. That was only December.
Okay.
And that far south, down in Philadelphia, down Trenton, New Jersey, that area, that was, that's how cold it was there. And you the winters at Valley Forge, the terrible winters that they had, you haven't been educated on the Revolutionary War. They don't do that anymore. But
well, I've, I know what happened.
You know that
yeah.
it happened.
But
those guys suffered terrible.
I didn't know what the weather was like.
Like in England, there's the artwork of the River Thames. I don't know if I'm saying it right.
Yeah, it's a TH, yeah.
Right. That river completely frozen over, and they're having fairs on it. You see the pictures of the people skating, and there's... It's sort of like a flea market with tents on the edges, and people were skating and whatnot, and you could buy stuff just like a flea market.
Mm.
But the point being, the river frozen solid over.
Okay.
Time period.
So I guess in light of that, like there's two parts to the argument that I find myself. I don't even want to call it an argument. The discussion that I find myself in normally, there's a global warming is not happening. It's happened in the past, but it's just. We're not experiencing that right now. And then there's B, all right, it's what's more common now in my discussion with mostly conservatives or just people that just don't believe in it is that it's happening. The all the indications are there that it's happening, but it's not caused by human industrial activity. In light of everything that you just said, your position on this is that global warming is a phenomenon, and we have documentation of this happening throughout the history of the planet. It's 4.5 billion years old. I think that we can document, you know, a few million years back. And with this information and with the trends that you see, like if you look at a line graph, you see trends, and we're not in the warmest epoch of the planet. This has happened before in the past. Climate fluctuates, and right now we may be seeing fluctuations, or we may just be seeing people with certain interests blowing up certain ideas and saying that this is happening because of global warming, but it's really just their special interests. That would be kind of my summation of where you stand on that.
So do you know, how about, let's start here now. Let's talk some science.
Okay.
Do you know how climate works?
There's a lot of indications of how, or there's a lot of ways the climate works, but yeah, I mean,
it's
climate works by
system.
The sun, it works by the orbit, it works by the tilt
right,
of the
right.
earth, it works
that,
by the ocean.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's the podcast that Stephen did with, and as to the oceans mainly drive the climate, because there's, you know, the huge body of water, the sun heats by the sun heating the oceans, and the clouds are, you know, and you know, all these things work together. It's a complex system. It's not like, it doesn't work where you pump one thing, pump a lot of CO2 and you're going to change the
sure.
climate. It's not going to work. If you cloud, you know, it's all going to be clouds, even though that, even the clouds would have a much more dramatic effect.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right?
Yep.
Then clouds really...
It's water
are,
vapor.
Yeah, right. Water vapor is the biggest greenhouse gas
yeah,
by
exactly.
far.
Yep.
And yet, the these people that are, you know, pushing this catastrophic, what did I forgot how to say, CAGW, the global warming, that catastrophic man-made global warming.
Mm-hmm.
They are welded to the thing of CO2,
sure.
And they did that even back in 1988, and did not. And one of the scientific things is they never studied anything else. They just decided it was CO2, and the science is settled.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the basic tenets of science is that science is never certain.
Sure.
All right.
Yep.
Another big tenet of science is that consensus is not science. Right, consensus is politics, and that's one of the easiest ways you know this is a political issue. Every time you hear that stupid 97% of the scientists, whatever, well, it doesn't matter. You only need one. One guy with a theory. Think of Galileo, you know, Einstein. Like, you know, back in World War II, when Einstein came up with some theory and the Germans didn't like it, they pulled out this whole consensus thing saying, oh, he's wrong and whatnot. They published this thing with 75 scientists say that Einstein's wrong, and his response was, 75, if they were correct, it only would take one. And that's why, you know, science is never certain. That's part of that. With science, if you have data, you don't hide the data. And, you know, you claim that, oh, this is...
Well,
this
getting,
is the way it is.
You're getting into... So now you're getting into the...
Well, that's what I'm just saying.
Stuff,
science,
right?
You share data. I'm just saying in
yeah.
general. I'm
okay.
not going to think he's aware.
I'm
not going to talk
about
how Michael Mann
and
Phil Jones, how these guys hide.
Yeah,
we can talk about that.
We can go to
we can talk about like the real inception of the climate science wasn't in 88 or 89 when Gore brought it out. It was ExxonMobil in like 66 started hiding information from people about CO2. The influence
emissions.
Of CO2 emissions and the influence that has on the change in the climate.
Well,
that's
they're under no obligation to. It's a private company. They're under no obligation to share whatever, you know, the work.
Well, maybe
they
not. Do. I mean, there's so many. I mean, how many thousands of laws?
But they're not
there?
Trying to change public policy, either. If you're going to come out with something and expect us to change public policy, you make that you show the data.
You're saying that petroleum companies don't try to change public policy?
Well, not like to the point that it is here. Of course, obviously, a lot of people do. They might, you know, yeah, they're big lobbyists.
Yeah,
they lobby. Everybody has to lobby because nowadays, and one of the reasons for that is that Congress has so far overstepped their authority that they have grabbed power that they shouldn't have, and they're selling that power. And on top of that, if you're a corporation and you have money, they're going to be looking to get a piece of that money. Sure. And you almost have to pay them off to leave you the hell alone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean,
Chris, stop.
I will be the first one to agree with that. Like, I don't like seeing money in politics in the first place, especially with regard to lobbying. And you certainly see it on all sides of the spectrum.
Yeah, I don't like that either. Now, let's look at what is the purpose of ExxonMobil, an energy company, right?
Yeah.
The purpose of them is to sell energy.
Sure.
Okay? And that's what their goal, that's what they're supposed to do. That's their job. That's what they make money on. Cruz, hey.
If Exxon spends its, or Exxon or any energy company spends its time and its money lobbying specific political characters in an effort for them to go in their political direction, I mean, that's influencing public policy.
Well, influencing political, you know, what do you mean by, what are they specifically after?
I think what he's getting at is that they want to obviously influence laws that benefit them. So they can make more money, so they can sell more stuff, so they can make it easier.
I could see them trying to open up ANWR in northern Alaska. Yeah. Right, lobbying to get, we want access to all that oil.
You know, the Dakota pipeline that you've got.
Yeah.
You know,
we want to put the pipeline, things like that.
Yeah.
To put the pipelines in.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, those kind of things. They probably have to spend money to lobby to get it done. Because there's no power in saying yes. If you're a politician, you're an elected politician, all your power is in saying no. That makes them come back and and they have to make a contribution. If you just say yes to everything that these people want, well, then you're all done. Now you're not needed anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But that's why these politicians love to say no.
Okay. So I think going back to the science thing, and I can go on the kind of the political tangent with regard to this for a while, but just kind of going back to the science thing, mm-hmm. consensus, you said consensus?
It's politics.
It's politics, okay. So, regardless of consensus being politics, if the data are there and we've reached a consensus, does it not make sense to take action? It seems like the position...
Let's go further. If the data is there, then it must be reproducible.
Sure.
It must account for the past.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to meet all these basic tests.
Does the data not account for the past?
No, it doesn't.
Okay, so...
How does the medieval warming period, how can you explain that?
What is the medieval warming...
The time of the Vikings.
Okay.
Greenland was green.
It was just much warmer than it is today, and there was no industrial...
Grapes. They grew grapes in Greenland and northern Canada.
Okay.
And England was making and exporting wines. Europe...
Were they seeing dramatic climate issues, like catastrophes?
It was hot. No.
It was just hot.
No, okay. In fact, the Vikings, remember, you've seen Viking boats, for example.
Yeah.
Right? And those boats, they sailed those boats to Greenland and to Canada.
Okay.
And the waters must have been calm for that.
Well, that's exactly the point. The North Atlantic, later on, became very rough. You know, think of the Titanic, where back when the North Atlantic was very rough then. But when the Vikings went, it was as still as a pond, they wrote about. In fact, I read an article about this years ago where the guy who was writing about it, he's more of a military historian, and he said back in the medieval warming period, the threat wasn't from global warming, it was from men in boats. And that was the Vikings. And he wrote about what the Vikings did, basically like the Hell's Angels going into Paris and, raping, robbing, pillaging the place. And so the French paid them off to make them go away, and they went away. But then they decided, you know what, we're going to go back for more. And they went back a second time, did the same thing.
Didn't the Vikings sail through the North Pole or something?
Well, the Chinese did. Around the same time period. China, has records that they sailed across the North Pole, and it was literally ice-free.
So, but going back to consensus as politics, like, if the data are there, it seems like you're making the point that this is bullshit because...
Well, the point is the data's not there. That's why...
The data for current warming trends are there. I mean, if you look at... Just carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it's way higher. Earth's temperature is way higher. We haven't seen temperatures like this since... I think it's 66 million years ago, something like that.
No, it was much warmer in the 1930s.
temperatures or I guess period. Just like changes in the environment. So
what do you mean, but what changes?
Well, we're losing almost all of our all the coral reef in the ocean is pretty much gone. They're considering it terminal stage. And the reason why that happened,
that's a point we could argue, because there's many scientists that say that's BS.
I would like to have one scientist send me a report like this, because
I think I can find it right now.
I read these things too, where they say there's no coral. I read scientists from Australia saying it's all BS.
I've never in my life seen one of these reports. I mean, everything that I see says, all right, we're in terminal stage. The coral reef is almost gone, and that's pretty easy to understand why that's happening. I mean, more CO2 in the atmosphere means more in the ocean, and they're starting to bleach, and they're just going away.
If that's true, again, I'd say that's a point of contention that not everybody agrees on.
I feel like it's really easy to identify that. So, like, this is another thing. When we start thinking about consensus as politics, I agree with that to an extent. But if the data are there, like, if we can look at coral reef and realize that they're disappearing, we don't really need to have a semantic battle on this. I mean, no. It's happening. It's there. Like, or it's almost not there. You know,
let me throw this at you.
Okay.
Where do you really think it's hotter now? That it's actually really hot now.
I do. I mean,
I'm trying to think in your lifetime.
I'm thinking about
the late '90s. There were some hot years in the late '90s. Mm-hmm. Some hot summers. Think about how many days in the last few years have been over 90 degrees here.
I've been living
about
in 95, Texas. So.
How about 100? Can you think of any? How many, think nationwide,
I'm not thinking about, like, Delhi, New York,
the place.
We've been keeping track of global temperatures for 150 years or something like that.
In the United States, yes.
Global temperatures for 150 years. So.
No, we don't have global temperatures.
Okay, so even the United States.
In fact, United States is the best. We have the best.
So we'll call the United States for 136 years, 150 years or something like that. And the hottest 15 years on record is since the year 2000, something like that. I mean, there's only a couple outliers in that. And
that is not true. The hottest years are in the 1930s. John Steinbeck's classic novel.
Yeah.
About the Dust Bowl.
Yeah, yeah, I just read it recently.
How hot it was in the Midwest.
Sure, sure.
And we don't touch those temperatures. You can go back and read the news articles of how the temperature records, you know, in the Midwest there and all around the area. How many days were over 100 degrees? For example,
I guess what I struggle with is if I read a NASA article
when you read a NASA article, you expect it to be true.
Yeah. And
did you know that NASA is tampering with the temperature data? Have you read of that, or did you know that?
No, no.
And NOAA. So, that's what I said.
Where did you read that NASA's
For example, I could look it up. I could show you right now. I could show you the graphs that the stuff they reported just a few years ago, and that they just change it, arbitrarily change it. There's a guy named Roy Spencer and John Christie, mm-hmm. were the managers of satellite temperature data. They've been predicting for years that they were going to start messing with that too, because their temperature data wasn't the same.
What's the game on that? Like, what is the point of it?
The game is to keep the heating trend going.
But why? Like, why? Well, what is, like, what's the end goal?
Billions of dollars involved in this, government money.
Think of
alternate energy companies like solar, wind, who are in their infancy.
They are
right
so
now.
Invested in
think
this.
Think of more government control. I mean, really, governments want one thing.
Why does that necessarily mean more government control?
Because who do you turn to fix the solution?
Well, see, that's the biggest.
If global warming is the problem, and emissions are the cause, and we're causing all the emissions, then it stands to reason that, I mean, who's the only? Look at the proposals from Congress. Everyone expects the government to do something about it.
Sure.
So that means the government has to have the power to do it.
And that's why I say this is the biggest clue that this was a scam. Was that the answer is always more government control, less individual liberty, more socialism.
Mm-hmm.
That's the ones when they keep pushing redistribution of wealth to nations. That's what your this last Paris thing. That's what that's all about. If you actually read the thing and look at it, all these countries are there signing on because they got their hands out.
Yeah.
You see them getting impatient because they slip every now and then. They want their money now. They need,
I can see the concern with bringing the government more into our lives. I can see the concern, especially from individuals such as yourself and myself. Like, I don't necessarily want it myself, but I feel like the science is like this is that idea is just clouding the vision of a lot of people that are really really heavy into this.
Why are they? I don't expect this from NOAA and NASA. I would expect them to report the temperatures as they record them. Mm-hmm. And now another thing is you got to watch out for. It's a guy named Anthony Watts did a nationwide survey of temperature stations. He's got a blog. And people from all over the nation are sending him pictures of the weather stations and whatnot. And he had a compilation of all of them and showing them how some people would send him pictures. Oh, this is the weather station in our town. It's been there for 80 years. So now the weather station has, you see, pavement. There's pavement all around it, air conditioning thing blowing on it.
Mm-hmm.
And, that thing obviously is not accurate.
Yeah, yeah.
And, there's a thing called urban effect.
I did hear
and there's a lot of weather stations compromised like that, for example, and that data doesn't do us any good.
I did hear something about this, but I've also read that those antiquated systems aren't really utilized in the science that is being brought to the public now, specifically within the NASA reports and the IPCC report. They're not using stuff like that at all anymore.
Do you even know what they're using?
Well, I'm going to try to sound this out because
most of it they make up. They make up most of it.
There was an argument about surface temperature, and I'm not going to do this any justice. There was an argument about surface temperature, and how if you're near pavement or if you're in your case next to or turn the air conditioning off, mm-hmm. or something like that, you can get skewed data. So they started looking at the average of surface temperature and what was in the troposphere or something like that to get more. Basically, what I'm saying is they've developed more different ways to get better readings, to get more accurate readings on global surface temperature.
They're messing with them.
They're
blatantly erasing what they did that they told us 5-6 years ago and replacing it with something else
because they get
it doesn't meet their what they're saying is happening. It doesn't meet the it doesn't keep the graph going, the hockey stick. In essence, it doesn't show the warming they want. And are you familiar with the ClimateGate emails? Stephen must have told you about them.
Yeah.
Did you read any of those and see what these?
Yeah, everything that people call ClimateGate, from what I've seen, are things taken out of context.
Okay, ClimateGate 1. What about ClimateGate 2?
Even ClimateGate 1. How about this?
ClimateGate 1 is questionable if you're not of that mind.
Well, there's some stuff they talk about.
ClimateGate 2 is different.
Mike's nature trick. Keeping people from being published.
Well, that's the second one.
That's the second one.
From what I understand, I don't know a lot about Mike's nature trick, but in a brief reading, it seems like seems like it is something that is very commonly done statistics. And after a lot of people looked at it, they're like, no, there's no wrongdoing in this, and they're not trying to pull an actual trick on the public. Like, it was just...
Well, this guy was. Michael Mann? Michael Mann erased the medieval warming period.
Don't know about that. Can't respond to
that.
Well,
what data?
Mm-hmm. And his hockey stick that was subjected to in Al Gore's movie. He made it go away.
Mm.
It was inconvenient.
Yeah.
So is that scientific?
No, that's the inconvenient truth, man.
Yeah, well, that's what it is. There's a very inconvenient
truth. There was another thing.
Mann.
There was another thing in there that was talking about the tree ring.
Tree rings.
Mm-hmm. The tree ring. What is it called, though?
Keith Briefa.
Key ring disturbance or something like that, and essentially they look at the tree rings and they would not corroborate the data that you have.
Well, they would only look at the tree rings they wanted to look at.
No. The tree rings. If you look at the tree rings, if you look at the tree, it does not corroborate the temperature rises that we've seen in the past 150 years. I mean, how accurate? How much information can a tree give you, anyways? If they're even 200-300 years old,
Nice weather, the ring is bigger.
It's a color of it. But how much information can that actually give you about global climate trends when we're looking at millions of years? So it sort of doesn't matter. But the people that were criticizing the tree ring, the whole tree ring argument, were saying they're trying to hide this from us because tree rings don't corroborate the temperature increases that we've seen in the past 150 years. That doesn't matter though, because we actually have the readings, the temperature readings of the past 150 years. So we don't really need. Okay, but so we don't really need the tree rings to corroborate that story. It's a phenomenon that, as far as I know, they actually haven't figured out why it happened. So it's just some random phenomenon. But it, like, when you actually have the readings, the temperature readings, you don't need that information to corroborate. So that was the other thing on ClimateGate.
Well, the thing about ClimateGate, I agree. I mean, I read this. I mean, I would say I read how they spun it, basically. I mean, I agree with the idea that they were corrupting data and they were doing things, they were deceiving things. But I can understand why, if you would read that, because they did a good job they did a good job of explaining it, just like you said. Oh, like, these are standard things done in the industry, this and that. And, I mean, I can't tell either way. I mean, there are people that agree and disagree with it, but I don't think, it wasn't very convincing. The second, ClimateGate 2.0, they called it, was the next stuff where you have emails of guys saying, oh no, don't give our data out anymore. Destroy the data if you have to. Do not let other people analyze our data. I think that's a bit more damning than ClimateGate 1. Mm. That I think you would see that. I haven't seen any. I see no one talking about ClimateGate 2.0 because I think you can't really spin that. You know, why wouldn't you want people to see the data? And to me, it's I think it's obvious.
What's your position on whistleblowers?
Depends. That could be a good thing. Whistleblowers.
I
think the ClimateGate emails, I think, were released by a whistleblower.
And that could be. But what I was trying to get with that is, it seems like the move for the Republican or conservative party, as far as whistleblowers go, is to criminalize them when they publish data because it's too sensitive for the public or whatever. Mm-hmm. Is it possible that immature data that hasn't been fully analyzed getting into the wrong hands, meaning the hands of someone that is going to interpret it not in the way that it should be interpreted, is it possible that would be a bad thing? I mean, if you're a scientist that spent years... If you're a scientist that...
Get him off, Mark.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Wow. Nice catch.
Yep, I'm good like that. Keep going. I got a little bit.
Yeah, but in science,
be a great podcast.
You know, you should be able. To, you know, you've got your data, and you present your case.
Right. But if you're
prepared to, you know, the best scientists, they will go out and debate and debate their position. And you don't see that with these global warming guys. They don't want to debate. They will not debate the likes of Tony Heller and John Christie, mm-hmm. the MIT guy. I can't remember his name now. Mm-hmm. Richard Lindzen, you know, these guys, they will not debate them. And Roy Spencer is a dorky, mild-mannered guy. I mean, he's quiet, very soft-spoken, and yet the head of the IPCC won't debate him.
I'd like to, if you wouldn't mind, just give me a list of those guys, because I wouldn't mind watching some videos or something on them.
I can show you. One of the better videos, I just saw this thing recently. I don't know if you sent it to me or not, but it was like this one guy said he was going to have the two video, you know, he wanted two videos. He got the best one that supports the case of global warming, and I want the best one that says it's not happening, you know, the opposite effect. So somebody sent him the one by Tony Heller about the how they're manipulating the data. And he's got graphs. He shows this is what NASA put up That's how I was explaining it. This is what NASA put up in 2004. Now in 2018, look, you know, now look, it's changed.
We watched that.
Right,
actually.
Right. Yeah. And the guy goes after, he goes, well, I watched this one first. And he goes, but after watching Tony Heller, he goes, really, you know, it really makes you think, what the hell are they doing?
What is the...
And you can go back, you know, he'll show you the, you know, this is one of the things, his hobby, he collects all this data, he collects the old New York Times pieces, for example, that talk about the climate, from how hot it was in the 1930s. He has a feature almost every day, like on this day in history, you know, it was, you know, it was like 85 degrees in Minnesota. You know, it was that way for a whole week. You know, just interesting stuff like that, and how hot it was, and then compare it to today. That's how I know that the amount of 100-degree days across the nation is way down. And you go back to the 1930s and see how many there were. And you can obviously see it was so much hotter.
That doesn't really speak to...
Well, it's just an example.
Global temperature.
Yeah. But what was your question before he was...
Well, that's the thing. Global. When you're talking global that means everything should be raising up. And there's many parts of the globe.
That doesn't necessarily mean that. I mean, we just had the polar vortex, which, I mean, you know, you can call it global warming, you can call it not, but changes in...
It's a thing that happens all the time. Back when, you know, back in the 70s, some of the same people, and I'll name some of them that you probably don't... Paul Ehrlich, you familiar with him?
Mm-mm.
John Holdren?
Mm-mm.
John Holdren was a science advisor for Obama. And to me, the guy's a lunatic, and I'll explain why. Steve Schneider, big global warming guy. These guys were all at the forefront of this global cooling thing. They were saying the same thing, that CO2 and industrialization, burning fossil fuels, was going to freeze us all, global warming or global cooling.
What was
and they just transitioned seamlessly to global warming.
It's the same
thing. And nobody says anything. It's just like just as bad as when everybody goes from global warming to climate change. Literally, overnight, they changed the term. The media's not interested in questioning these people. But these same people that were pushing the global cooling thing, catastrophic global cooling. Mm. Seamlessly go to catastrophic global warming for the same with the same reasons.
Yeah.
So, you know, but how is that science?
Lesser,
or is that just alarmism?
That's a lesser informed populace.
Now, Paul Ehrlich, he wrote a book called The Population Bomb, and he said that within the next 10 years or so, or less, that we're going to be out of all these commodities. And there was another economist that said, "I'll take that bet." Then I'll bet they bet, I forget what they bet, and they had 10 or 12 things, and the guy, Ehrlich, was 0 for 12.
Hmm.
And that's another thing that, you know, I've heard my whole life, is that we're running out of oil. We were supposed to run out of oil by like 1999, or even, it might have even been earlier than that, when Jimmy Carter was president.
Yeah.
I was just reading about some of that, you know, reminiscing of that recently, and... So I've been hearing that constantly. Yet nowadays, and that's the point that the guy made with Ehrlich, the economist that bet him. He said, "What you're not taking into account is all the technology we're going to develop in the next, you know, 10 years or so, that's going to make it easier to get all this stuff out. And there's technology that's going to be, you know, at the end of this century, that people will have that we've never even thought of. Think of the people in 1900." That, you know, would they have ever thought of the technology, you know, the cell phones, for example, you know, or that, you know, that we have been to the moon, jet travel. They couldn't even fathom that. There was no, 1900, there was nobody, there was no airplanes then.
There's a lot of people who think us landing on the moon was a hoax, too.
That could be for another podcast.
Yeah. I think what I really come down to is looking at, again, looking at the data and looking at just the science of the greenhouse effect, you know, when it's really boiled down, it's not like a really complex thing to understand. No. I mean, you look at...
It works in a closed environment. It works in a lab.
Yeah.
But it doesn't work that way with the Earth.
Does it not, though? I mean, if you look at major changes in global climate in history, and I'm talking in the millions of years...
You're talking over billions of years.
Yes, yeah. A lot of these... We've had Well, we've had five major extinctions in the 4.5 billion years, and we've had several ice ages and, what is it, when glaciers go away.
Melt.
Yeah, but there's a word for it. Yeah, but there's something that causes that, right?
In the Midwest, I forget if it was Kansas or something, or even I think of the Grand Canyon, that was under 100 feet of water.
Yeah, there were hippos in Great Britain at one point. But and I understand that, I get that, but major global climate changes have happened in history, and they've all happened because of some sort of dumping of greenhouse gases.
Well, we don't know that. I would say, how about asteroid hits?
Yeah, that's a major dumping of a greenhouse gas. I mean,
that'll block out the sun. In essence, like, think of, you know, the last major event like that I can think of was maybe 1814 down in near New Zealand, in that area, Indonesia area. A tremendous volcanic eruption, and that was the up here it was called the year with no summer.
Yeah,
where Washington D.C. it snowed in June.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which is incredible.
Yeah,
you know, being as hot and humid as that place is, and that one volcano changed the weather. You could say for the year.
That's weather. Yeah.
But it was cold. Shit wouldn't grow, you know, for the farmers because it never really got hot.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That blocked out the sun. To control the climate, you got to block out the sun. You have to be able to control the sun. You got to prevent the sun from heating the oceans.
Yeah. So, yeah, the sun creates all the energy, or most of the energy on the planet. And it's the balance of those greenhouse gases and a couple of different things that kind of organize our global climate. Is that fair?
Sort of. You know, climate science is in its infancy.
Okay.
There's an awful lot they don't know.
Do you disagree with that? I agree with that in some respects, but I think that there's a lot that we do know. I think that there's a lot that we do know.
There's a lot they do know.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is, science has to be reproducible. You can, you know, if your theory is not reproducible, it's still just a theory.
Sure.
It's not settled, and it's not the way things are.
Right, but I think that what we're arguing here is the semantics around this climate discussion, where, like, you're not saying that there's no chance that climate change is happening. What you're saying is that the science is unsettled, and therefore I don't think that we should mess with our economic system too much, or our social system too much. What I'm saying is, like, there are a lot of indicators out there. The science is out there. There are people that are way, way smarter than us all over the world that are debating this in a lot more detail, with a lot more data.
One side doesn't
maybe
like
not
the debate.
Maybe not debating, but having putting out information, anyways. So the information is out there. So on one hand, on your hand, you're saying science isn't settled and we shouldn't change our life because of it. And on the other hand, we have people like me who, you know, I'm going to be on this planet for quite a lot longer, and there's a lot of information out there that's saying, no, human industrial activity in the past 150 years has drastically changed the planet.
Drastically
changed the planet.
How and so?
We don't even have to talk about, like, specifically global warming. We can talk about putting pesticides into our oceans. We can talk about just the constant tilling of the land. We can talk about clearing of forests. I mean, there's so mountaintop mining. I mean, there's so many things. Well, let me finish this. So, you know, if we can sit here and argue the semantics of this, or we can say, all right, these indicators are there. Maybe it's not reproducible in a lab or something like that. At this point, I don't really want to debate climate science anymore. I think that if we have so many people on the planet that believe this is happening, and the population on the planet that believe that climate change is happening and that's caused by humans is way bigger than the population that claim the other hand, and that's just how
science is done.
No, I'm not saying I'm not saying that's how science is done. I'm just saying, all right, there's way more people and there's way more professional climatologists that are on this hand than this hand.
Are they?
Yes, there are. So,
well,
you know, with that,
that? With the money,
with that, with that,
if you want any money, if you want to get hired, you've got.
With that being said, why wouldn't we want to make changes? You know, if I guess I never really considered the fact that we don't want government in our lives more. And if the changes only imply that the government gets in our life, I understand that argument. But I look at all of the things that humans have done to change the landscape in the past. I'll look at the United States and I'll look at over the past 300, 400, or 500 years. It is dramatic. I mean, you can't use any other word for it.
Have you got any pictures of Delaware County from the 1930s, 1920s,
1810, I have a painting of Oneonta, and all of the mountains are completely cleared. And
it's got to be later. That's got to be like 1910.
Why?
But yeah, 1810.
It's like late 1800s. I don't know.
Yeah, but late 1800s. Right.
Maybe late 1800s.
The mountains. You look in the old pictures. That was the point I was making. All the trees are gone.
All gone. Yeah, all gone.
Look now.
I understand that, and that makes sense. There's much more emphasis on reforesting, and then there's also more carbon in the sky, so you're getting the global greening effect. I mean, that makes sense as well.
This is a point I'm going to make. The Earth is not fragile. Okay, think World War II.
Sure.
How many ships were sunk in World War II?
Don't know.
Right. Well, off the coast of Florida, off the coast of Georgia, South Carolina. German U-boats were there knocking out ships.
Sure.
Okay. Oil flooding up on the shores.
Mm-hmm.
They said it turned everything black.
Yeah.
Somehow, and nobody cleaned it up.
Yeah.
No, and and you'd never know it.
Yeah.
In like just a few years, you don't even read about it because nobody just was gone and cleaned up.
Because we can't see the residual. Like, mm-hmm.
I know when I was in Florida in the late 70s, in my grandmother's place in Delray Beach, sometimes you could walk on the beach and sometimes you'd see little black things. You'd step on them. It'd stick to your foot. And my grandmother was saying that was oil.
Okay.
Basically. That's what happened to it, I guess.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is the earth cleanses itself.
It's just, it is much too convenient an argument to say the earth just cleanses itself. I mean, we're like 2.5 times beyond the carrying capacity of the earth as it is just in human population.
That's what Paul Ehrlich was saying. And Paul Ehrlich was totally proven wrong.
So you don't think there's too many humans on the planet?
We're not over capacity yet at all.
Really? You said we were going to be over capacity in 2000, right?
You could go back to all the last century and read this constantly, people saying stuff like that. Alarmism is nothing new. Even as far back as in the 1800s, they were talking about alarmism like that, just like the people today.
Mm-hmm.
How the world's going to end and whatnot. But we are not. We are nowhere near. All the people in the world can still fit in the state of Texas.
Sure, sure. It's just something that I would have to disagree on.
It's something that's almost self-correcting. And that was one of the points.
Self-correcting is how humans lived up until like 10,000 years ago. How the whole planet was in homeostasis. Now it's a cancer. It doesn't self-correct anymore. Humans are taking over the planet. We're going to pave everything. We're going to trim everything. And we're just going to drain everything until there's nothing left.
How long does it take for nature to bust up pavement and stuff to grow through it?
We just rebuild over it. So
yeah.
Well, if we're still here. The Earth will be gone. The Earth will still be going. And it won't even miss us.
Well, sure. Yeah. No, and that's... Yeah, I totally agree with that. Yeah.
He wants people to survive. I think this is what we have to realize. Is that, he's not a member of the degrowth movement. Degrowthers legitimately want... I mean, in the
know,
words of one of their leaders, I mean, it's only until the right virus can come along and kill all of us.
Yeah, they can't wait for that.
But at the same time, just kind of listening to the conversation, when you describe us as a cancer, it shadows what the degrowth movement...
I don't know anything about the degrowth, but the first time that you said that, I was like, yeah, give me some of that. This is another podcast. I don't really like the theory behind capitalism. I think it works in a lot of ways, but the whole idea of like perpetual growth is kind of what we're doing. Everything's working out. And it's just, in my opinion, what I see is it's destroying the planet. And I don't think that's alarmism. I think that if you look at a lot of the signs, again, look at all the industrial activity aside from the dump of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere and everything that's going to happen because of that. I mean, it is pretty stark.
Who's cleaner, the United States or China?
The United States is way. I mean, you look at pictures of China; it's horrible. It's terrible. But that doesn't make it better. Like, I don't want to say China's doing so much more. So I'm not gonna.
No, well, you want to see real pollution? You go to you should have looked back in the day in the old Eastern Europe.
Sure. I'm not saying.
And look at China today in India. Sure. Yeah, the United States. We have the capitalism gave us the technology to clean up the diesel engines that I remember. Growing up, that they used to blow black smoke out, and it could hardly go up a hill pulling the load, just blowing black smoke out, and they stunk. Nowadays, I smell it's like clean diesel.
Sure.
We've come so far with that.
Yeah.
And gasoline engines, we don't use the carburetor. There's fuel injection now. These engines burn so clean to the ones that I worked on growing up.
And I'm not saying that they're not. I'm also
That's
not
what
saying
capitalism,
that like
and capitalism is nothing more than really economic freedom, economic liberty. You going out. Buying the cell phone that you want to buy. You go out, pick this pair of shoes you want and buy them and decide I'm going to pay this price for them or not.
Yeah.
That's all capitalism is.
Yeah. Yeah.
You might hear, think of it as something else, but you might be thinking of like crony capitalism.
Well, no, I think of surplus. So I think that capitalism is a system that survives on surplus. And surplus really just feeds more.
Surplus what?
Surplus product. So, like, it started in agriculture. I mean, in agrarian times, you know, at the start of things, you would grow enough food for yourself. And, well, you really started hunting and gathering, so you'd gather enough food for yourself. And then you started farming. So farming is this thing where we got a little bit more sedentary and you started growing enough food for yourself, but then you started producing a little bit of surplus.
Yeah, well,
and this is where currency
increased. Sure. You can now look, the amount of food these people are producing today is incredible.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. And I think it's very short term.
Just the whole thing of a supermarket.
Now without consequences.
No, it's terrible consequences.
You can get almost any food you want 24 hours a day.
Sure.
365 days a year.
Yeah.
And that's something
that grows more humans.
Could only dream of.
Sure, I get that, and that's great in a lot of
and
respects.
That's not, in Cuba, you can't do that.
And again, it's
in Venezuela. There's nothing on the shelves.
It's great in a lot of respects, but you go back to this like self-limiting thing, and humans have no way to limit themselves. I mean, we're going to constantly grow until we outgrow the host. That is what's going to happen.
Well, you have people. Not that, especially like in Europe now, where they're not even reproducing enough to replace themselves. And that was one of the points I was going to say.
True.
The economist, that's what happens. When your resources aren't there, you get to a point where they, it just stops.
I mean, if you look at on the global scale, resources are there. There's never been more food on the planet because the populations keep growing. That's the only sign that you need that they're, that there's more food on the planet than there's ever been, but
they're producing it and it's cheap. It's relatively cheap.
Yeah,
because they can mass produce it very easily.
Yeah, and in the meantime, they're draining. All the top 10 feet of topsoil from the Great Plains
is
gone.
I've heard that too. But somehow every year they're able to grow crops.
Yeah.
Do you think the farmers want to get rid of their topsoil?
No, but they're in this system that. You have to keep on going. It has to be cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. And I don't really think that a lot of attention is paid to what actually happens right there or downstream.
Well, if the farmers, they take care of their, if it's their land, they're taking care of it and managing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's government-owned land that nobody takes care of and is mismanaged.
In what respect?
Well, and when you own your own thing, you care about it. There's the old economic theory of the four ways to spend money. Okay, and you can, the most efficient way is you spending money on yourself. Because you care about cost and you care about quality.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You spend your money on someone else, you'll care about cost, you don't care so much about quality. You spend government, say you're a government worker, and you're spending money that's not yours on yourself. You don't care about cost, but you'll care about quality.
And
if you spend government money, someone else's money, on someone else, you don't care about cost, you don't care about quality.
Sure.
So,
okay.
And you can look at it that way. That's the whole thing about private property.
And,
you maintain your own stuff better than you would something else.
And in theory, that does work. And
that's like an undeniable truth of life.
Well, it is denial. I mean, I can give you a case in point. Like, if you look at a lot of farmers in this area, do you think that they're practicing regenerative farming? Because I've seen someone that's very close to me plow a field and plant the same crop every year for 25 years.
Know what he's doing?
No, I mean, it's just like these are things that happen, and they happen. They happen all the time. This is conventional farming. Man, we're gonna. This is a different rabbit hole. I think.
Yeah. I get what you're saying. Chad is saying basically that global warming is tied to this need to constantly grow, and that has consequences. We can talk about the food that he's talking about. Like, sure, you can keep growing these red bell peppers, but when you deplete the soils of the nutrients, even if you know,
I kind of thought that was a basic thing of farming, rotating crops. I mean, I'm not a farmer, but I know that.
Go to the Midwest and see. Corn and soy everywhere for hundreds of miles. I mean, that's just what you see, and it makes sense why we have this plume of gross algae growth in the Gulf.
Corn for the meth. They don't care how good the corn is.
No, they don't give a shit. Right?
And tortilla chips.
Yeah, yeah. It, you know, it's and it makes sense that there's just this complete depletion of topsoil, and then all the fertilizers run downstream in the Mississippi, and then they all go out into the Gulf, and that's how we get this major algae. You're better off
on your small scale growing your own food.
Yes.
No question
yes.
about that.
Yeah, and what he's saying is that even like, so we can talk about, you know, I think you and I would agree about all these benefits of capitalism, all this mm-hmm. stuff, but we also have to be real about the consequences too. There's no oh, well, this is just, you know, we can introduce this new technology or, you know, farm this certain mm-hmm. way and only get benefits. There are always benefits and consequences and costs. There's always a positive and a negative.
I know, one of the consequences of capitalism is that it brings more goods and services to more people, brings mm-hmm. more affluence to more people than any other system known yet.
Mm-hmm. And yet,
We have to define affluence, though. That's a different.
I mean, we're getting into economics now. I'm going to bring us back to global warming because I know.
Oh,
I mean,
boy,
unless you'd like to continue. I mean, this is a conversation.
The whole affluence thing, you know, it's bringing affluence. Depending on how you define affluence, but it's also bringing a species of humans, all of which are highly specialized and can't really do a hell of a lot outside of what they're specialized
on. That's not capitalism.
Oh, all right. I see we're going into capitalism, and I love it. We're going to go there, but I'm going to end the global warming discussion. I'm going to ask both of you one interesting question.
Okay.
So, this is good. So, both of you, obviously, I mean, you've been spending your entire life looking at this stuff. You are extremely passionate about this issue. What would it take for you to change your mind? So, like, and I mean, like, generally, like, so, like, in your case, like, would it take, if we showed you all this information that he knows, and you read, scientists, like, naming specific guys, oh, this guy in the IPCC, he did, like, if you could find it within yourself, what would it take for you to genuinely change your position, where you'd say, you know what, oh, wow, global warming may be a hoax, you know, maybe this whole thing is a lie, and same thing for you, what data, or what would you want to see that would say, whoa, holy crap, we're actually affecting the climate. Humans are having this big impact on the climate that we need to do something about. So I don't know who wants to go first, but what would it take? Take a moment. I mean, it's fine. Take a moment.
Yeah, first of all, I would have to see that it's actually getting hotter around the world. You know?
All right, so let's say a scientist explained to you.
I would have to actually see that.
Well, what if he said, okay, listen, it's not like, what if he had some scientific way of explaining it to you where it's like, okay, it's not, you know.
The data are there. Like, it depends on what article you read, but that the data are there saying that it is in fact.
Well, you're saying the data is there. The data, I say the data is not there.
Right.
I know. So the question is,
I can show you stuff.
This is what I was talking about the other day. Ultimately, this is where we end up.
The reason I ask this,
but I would say this: it clearly is not getting hotter. There's no the amount of you would expect to see more 90-degree days. More 100-degree days around the globe. If this was the case,
he's saying that the data is saying that
global temperatures are rising. That's it's out there. It exists, and it's by pretty reputable sources. So the fact that we may not see as many 90-degree days in New York, it's a completely different story.
We could see worldwide. You know, I had a, and I've lost it because it's in that computer, saved in the favorites, the one that crashed. Mm-hmm. There was a website that would show a picture of the globe. You could go anywhere on the globe and get the temperature at it. And
find it online somewhere.
Yeah, I don't remember the name of it, but it was really good. You could zoom in on airs. Like, I used to test it for accuracy. I would zoom in on Delhi and see what the temperature said. It was right on every time.
Yeah.
And so I'm reading articles how, the ice is all melting in the Arctic. And I'm thinking, well, gee, I just read about how cold it was up there the other day, seeing the webcams in the northern part of Alaska. And so I would zoom in on the Arctic, and it would be like 40 below zero.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, the last time I knew, ice doesn't melt at 40 below zero. And again, the people that are many in the global warming movement called their prophet is James Hansen. Now, James Hansen said that Manhattan, or the West Side Highway, would be underwater by now. Okay? You can go there, I don't know, you could still drive in the West Side Highway. I was just there fairly recently. In fact, the water's not even coming up anywhere near it.
Mm-hmm.
That's because we had Obama.
They make all these predictions. And I've been hearing these predictions for 30 years now.
So the only way that
not
you
a
would,
single one of them.
So the only way that you would believe it is if it happens.
Right. If we start seeing temperatures starting to go up. We start seeing, all these dire things starting to happen. If they even were remotely beginning to happen.
Okay.
Anything that their models are always wrong. And therefore, no, you got to do better than that.
Mm-hmm.
So you would want them to say basically.
I want to see evidence. Okay.
Well, no, he's saying that there is proof, but you don't accept it because you think
data
is skewed.
Well, he says you're saying data,
and you're not also seeing results in your
data
real
telling
world.
Us that the oceans are rising, and the data's telling us it's getting hotter. I don't see it getting hotter anywhere.
It's just that you're not reading those sources. I understand that you do.
I see the data that you see. I'll guarantee you that.
Mm-hmm.
I see the data, but I also see the rebuttal to it.
Mm-hmm.
What you're not seeing is like you don't see the stuff.
I see the rebuttal too. So this is I actually
because
expressed
you don't
this
know
to Steve
that
the other night.
Skewing the data, you hadn't heard that.
And that I mean that's like again that's a really that's just a convenient little thing to say. Like they're skewing.
Well,
they're skewing.
I think you have to look at the evidence of it. I mean, have you looked at the evidence?
No. I will. I'll look into it.
Have you even heard about it?
Of them skewing the data.
Most people I talk about and have no idea.
No, I have heard the stuff with the climate gate, and then I heard the stuff about the temperature technology not taking
the
accurate.
The satellite and the ground-based things, how they were different.
Yeah, yeah. But I still, like, if you look at stuff using technology from 2019, again, I'll reference the most reputable resources that I know of, which is NASA and IPCC. They're going to
political. IPCC.
Everything's
political.
Everything's political.
And that's the point with me. This has become a political issue.
Right.
Even
right.
So,
and,
though,
and,
even
but
so
they,
though, like we can't. I don't want to get into a point where it's like, oh well, it's the government agency, so it must be wrong. Like if we're going to call things out, we got to be like, all right, agency. Let's look at the data. Challenge the data, not the agency or the source. Like that because that happens to me all the time. Oh, you must be a right winger, a conservative, so you're just wrong in everything. Or you, you support Trump, so you're a Nazi. I mean, we got to start challenging the idea and the data.
That's why I'm a real world kind of guy. I'll look at the temperatures to see how's the temperatures in San Diego? How's the temperatures up in Seattle? How about in Minnesota? Down in Texas, down in Florida. What do we see?
But if we look at global averages,
those are
the numbers that I'm.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm looking at just the global average. That's where they're saying, all right, we're seeing a verifiable increase in temperature based on.
But meanwhile, they also talk about what they're calling the pause, and they talk during ClimateGate, they're talking about how they're going to respond to this. They know that there's a pause.
What is a pause? What do you mean?
The pause in their rising heating. It's leveled off.
Right now.
And that's inconvenient for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's actually a good example.
And they continue to change data because they don't want this flat line. They need that line to go up.
What he's referring to, actually, it was actually made public, I think, when Ted Cruz, there's a famous video of Ted Cruz questioning the Sierra Club, director of the Sierra Club, about that.
Mm.
And the guy, I mean, when he asked him about it, he said, what do you make of this data and everything about the Hawes? And the guy turned back, I guess, to his
advisor, right?
Whoever it was. It was kind of funny. So he turned back to him and he just goes, we just agree with the consensus that scientists say things are warming.
Yeah. That's all. when is the pause? Because you know, I mentioned
what the pause is.
I mentioned it earlier, but like based on global temperature averages, the globe has experienced the hottest years on record, like 15 of the past 18 years or something. I don't know what the actual number is, but it's
not even close.
Let me put it this way. So obviously we're all about, we want the truth, obviously. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This point. Yes. We want clear, concise, correct data. You've read a lot of data your entire life looking at this stuff, researching stuff, caring about this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
This kind of goes back to my question. If he could show you, if he showed you his evidence, where maybe some guy archived NASA records and said, hey, this is what NASA released in 1996, and said that, you know, global averages were this. In 2019, they're saying, oh, it's this now. Would that be convincing enough for you to say, oh, wow, I guess they are skewed? Like, that, it goes back to my question. What would it take for you to change your position on it? What would it look like? Would it look like him showing you data that showed that maybe they are skewing the data? Like, what would it honestly look like?
I mean, it's a hard question.
The reason I'm asking is because if there's nothing that would change your mind on it, then I think, and this goes for you too,
mm-hmm.
if there's nothing that would change your mind on it, then I think both of you would be too rigid. And if any time we're too rigid, I think that's when we're not being as truthful as we can be.
I can say this,
in other words, that's how you know you're wrong.
Sure, sure.
You have
there are things beyond climate change that we can identify that human industrial activity is disrupting. I mean, there's evidence that you can't argue with it. You can't argue with, you know, the clearing of the rainforest. You can't argue with ocean acidification. Well, I guess you can argue with ocean acidification.
I think all these things are arguable. I've been hearing reforestation.
Okay, let's look at the rainforest.
What's that?
We talked about this.
Reforestation in the United States. But
one thing about the rainforest is that this is something I heard about years and years ago. And there were these alarmists were talking about how many acres they were destroying a day, and it's so terrible. If you actually took the numbers and ran the numbers, they would have wiped out South America in just a matter of months.
They were
lying about it.
Yeah, I mean,
so you actually took the data they were throwing at you and get your calculator out and see how much they were actually doing. It was ridiculous.
Again, all right, so we can argue semantics or we can argue numbers, but like it does happen. It is happening, and with the election of Jair Bolsonaro, he's been saying that
now, because I've been hearing this for almost 30 years. So how could there possibly be any rainforest left? They should have had the rainforest wiped out decades ago.
Yeah.
If they were serious about it.
Okay.
That's one of these things again that I've been hearing for so long I can't even tell you.
All right. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you this.
McDonald's too is one of the culprits behind that.
Yeah. Let me ask you this then. So a lot of, and one of the reasons I really wanted to have you guys on is because, you know, he's probably been hearing this. We grew up listening to, eighth, ninth grade, even tenth grade in biology. We got like a triple dose of it, or at least a double dose. You know, he's saying he was in our shoes growing up. He heard all this stuff, all the catastrophes, you know, all the things caused by human activity, all these, you know, everything, all these crises that we need to do stuff now about. Here he is 30 years later, you know, maybe today, you know, like, I'll go back to my question. If, let's say, if the data that we present, that maybe, you know, he can show the data skewed, maybe that's still not convincing to you. If you're 50, 60 years old, and you realize that, you know, I've spent a lifetime hearing the same stuff and nothing's come to fruition, would that be more convincing to you that maybe some of this stuff is more alarmist than fact?
After a 30-year span.
I think that... It's a good point. Very good point. It's a very good point. I think that we're already seeing a lot of things happening right now that are caused by global warming. So it's tough for me specifically ocean acidification and specifically
that's an arguable point again. Well, sure, I've been hearing that for a long, long time.
Yeah.
My foot when I stick my by now my if I stick my foot in the ocean it should be burned off.
It doesn't take a lot. No, it doesn't take a lot.
Like I said, 30 years from now, are you gonna agree with all? Are you gonna have the same ideas you have today about this everything going on? And then you're going to see, you know, when you have kids and stuff, like, they're going to talk global warming, climate. They're going to talk all these same things. I mean, you're going to
say... Are they? I mean, like...
I think so. Acid rain.
I think so.
Do you remember? Did you ever hear about acid rain?
I did hear about acid rain. Yeah,
that was another fad.
Yeah.
That went away.
Well, I think predictions are bullshit. Like, they're not like. Predictions don't really do us a lot of good because, you know, and this is another area that we can really climb down a stupid rabbit hole, but, like, you know, there are a lot of predictions that are withheld because people that believe in climate change don't want to cause panic. And people on the right are just going to call that bullshit. They're just going to call that bullshit. You know, that to me is real. So I really don't think that there's any accurate way of looking at our current situation and saying this is what's going to happen in 30 or 40 or 50 years. That I don't believe in. I believe anecdotally that, like, right now we're seeing things that are caused by climate change. I think that the science of the mechanism of human-induced climate change is fairly understandable, even for my head, and it all makes sense. So I guess, you know, the whole consensus conversation, you know, I didn't realize that people were so adamant about, or that people that were against my view were so adamant about it being bullshit. You know, I even hear, like, I listened to Ben Shapiro the other day, and he was like, you know, I think that 97% is bullshit, but it does look like,
how they did that, actually.
This is why he's old.
And that's okay. Yeah. But he was like, but, you know, if you do look at the data and you look at the consensus, blah, 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 it does look like around 80% of worldwide professional climatologists believe in global warming and believe that it is caused by humans. That was from Ben Shapiro.
He said that?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. And I can get you the episode and the minute number, because that's when I tried to call you last week.
Like I said before, it only takes one.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we go back to this whole thing, like, you know, if we have this consensus, and put it in air quotes because that can be highly debated, we have this consensus, people around the world, very professional people that we should take seriously around the world, are saying this is a serious problem. I would prefer to address it rather than say, let's go business as usual. I'm probably different than a lot of people just because, you know, I also think that business as usual is not good for mankind. Mm-hmm. You know, that's kind of where I stand. And that's not a communism thing. That's not a socialism thing. Mm-hmm. I don't think any of those things really work in practice, but I don't have a lot of faith in.
There's plenty of history to show to demonstrate whether it works or not.
Yeah, I'm in the midst
and
of studying.
What works and what doesn't? If you ever fly, for example, over there's literally Koreas and see South Korea and North Korea at night, or even see San Diego and Mexico at night.
There's literally nothing in history that is proven, though. I mean, you can't say capitalism is proven. You can't say democracy is proven.
I'd say everything, it's a good track record. Pretty good evidence.
It's only existed for a couple hundred years. I mean, the Roman Empire existed for 2,000 years, and where's that nowadays? So, like, if you look at any single thing throughout the span, we'll just call it the span of our species' existence, call it 300,000 years. The only thing that really withstood the test of time was, like, hunting and gathering and tribalism. That's where I kind of find myself.
Right, well, you got a point there, because that's almost the default position. Almost the default position is tyranny, because there's people that always
That's not tyranny.
Well, I mean, take over other people. That style of government, where there's tyranny is the norm around the world.
Well, the hunting and gathering and tribalism, there was no tyranny in that. That was egalitarian.
Well, about the tribal thing, like, tribes fighting, you know.
Yeah, but it wasn't, like, it's not like, the evidence wouldn't suggest that it was.
Tyranny around the world is the norm. If you look around the world, there's very few places that have any liberty. And there's no place that has become the industrial giant that we became.
I don't think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Like, the standard of living you have now is because of that.
I do have issue with this, with standards of living. Like, there.
Meanwhile, your grandfather would hit you over the side of the head with a 2x4.
No, he would. He would. He would. Well, actually, no. He had a lot more money than I have. So.
Regardless, you know, you take some of the old farmers around here.
Yeah.
I mean, as hard as they work, and you don't appreciate what you got here, they'd be hitting you with a 2x4.
Well, I grew up farming. I mean, been farming,
right, but compared
whole
to
life.
The lives of these, the, you know, just a couple of generations before, how tough it was.
Yeah, and I mean that's fine, back. But it's not exponential. The more that you go back, And there's a lot of evidence to suggest that.
It gets harder and harder. You go back to the early 1900s when building the stone walls or clearing the
but go back 11 or 12,000 years ago and find cancer, find diabetes, find arthritis, find...
We definitely would have had some of that.
No, it almost didn't exist.
Well, no, because people just did not exist. Like, people just died.
That's not true.
Okay, look at it this way. Look at this.
Lifespan and life expectancy are two completely different things. So life expectancy is this average of what you think how long something lives, or on average. Lifespan has been pretty constant for humans. So you can potentially live to 70, 80, 90 years, maybe 100 years.
Not many people did. Not 1800s. You're talking 35, 40 years old. Most people are...
I'm not talking about 1800s, though.
He's talking about hunter-gatherers.
Yeah.
They live longer
I'm not saying that they have... that they necessarily have longer lives. I'm saying that they were healthier people. I'm saying that they're happier people. That's a big one. That's a big thing.
Yes. How would you measure that? Happier?
Hey, I'm not an anthropologist, but this is the stuff that I study.
How would you know they were happier?
Just based, I don't know, based on records. I'm not sure. I personally don't know how. Like, this is just based on the anthropologists that I've read.
When you're talking about hunter-gatherers, how far back are you going?
Hunter-gatherers, I mean, we use this date of like 11,500 years ago is when modern domestication and, well, not modern, but domestication and a lot of the agrarian practices that we know today started. Obviously, that's not just like a blanket statement for the globe. So some were probably before that, some were probably after that. But we use a number of 11,500 years. Or anthropologists do. I'm not an anthropologist.
You know, this is almost a different topic.
But it is. It's way different.
You know, when you talk about no cancer and whatnot, and I think the way, you know, nowadays people can move around the world very quickly and easily. Like someone with a lot of, you know, let's say if you have Mediterranean DNA, mainly where you come from, and your body is biologically programmed to eat that kind of diet. Mm-hmm. From that area over the course of thousands of years, that's what your ancestors were eating.
Yeah.
And now you come somewhere else and start eating a different diet, you're liable to be a little messed up.
Yeah, yeah, and that's what's happened to the Western diet. I mean, that's why you have some of these instances of...
And the process, you could say in the last, you know, because my grandparents didn't have processed food growing up. You know, much later in their life they did.
Yeah, and they still smoke cigarettes like crazy, and they were just like skinny. Well, and
they worked at a lot of physical labor, people. Yeah. Back two generations, from me, I guess three generations for you, could say, people still did a lot of manual labor. The transportation for food wasn't so good, so mainly they were eating local food.
Yeah.
And still then, three generations ago, you didn't have as much people traveling around like you do today, you can easily travel long distances now and move one place to another very easily and change your diet. But I really think it's the processed foods. The corn syrup and whatnot that we're not biologically programmed. Nobody's really programmed.
The pesticides, and
what you feed to the things that you eat.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
I remember, for example, I could go to a school, and I remember in like junior high when I went to junior high, all the girls were skinny. You know, it was rare to have a fat girl.
The good old days.
None of them were developed. Like almost none of them had breath. Or anything. And now, you can 13, 14 year olds.
Yeah. It's funny, because of all the estrogen in foods or estrogenic foods, girls are starting puberty much younger and guys much later.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, they're bigger, but, back in the guys in the 50s, 40s, and 50s around here that worked on the farms every day were probably a hell of a lot stronger.
I always got jealous. I'd look at pictures of my dad when he was like 14. He's got these big mutton chops. I'm still like working on a dirt stash, you know? Years of eating Hot Pockets, I think.
Not enough Hot Pockets.
I don't know.
Not enough nice... Well, we'd usually burn the germs off the raw stock at the hut there, but...
Yeah. I think that the consensus is neither one of us are going to believe it till we see it, huh?
I guess that's
to me. You got to have to get the politics out of it.
Yeah, and I totally couldn't agree more.
I think that has poisoned it tremendously.
Mm-hmm.
The whole the political thing. It's like it's not even science.
Yeah.
That they don't adhere to the rules of science. If these guys, some of these scientists that are prominent out there talking, were so sure about it, they would have no problem debating it mm-hmm. with somebody that had the opposite view. They would want to debate him and crush him in a debate. And you don't see that.
Yeah.
They just say their attitude is, oh, no, it's settled. I don't have to debate it. I'm not going to waste my time.
It's kind of cliche to bring it up, but have you ever examined the how closely the climate discussion matches the cigarettes cause cancer discussion or cigarettes are bad for you discussion?
No, actually,
has that ever like?
No, I wouldn't. It's not the same kind of political issue.
I'm just talking about
secondhand smoke. I don't think there's, I don't know. Again, that's something very tangible that I could, I remember. Secondhand smoke? See, you don't remember going into a bar.
Oh, I do. I remember going to Pizza Hut when you could smoke.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Remember that? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to think of when that was. That was
early 90s.
You're in Pix. Pix used to be a, you can smoke.
Well, Pix kind of went against the grain for a long time.
10 or 11 years old, I think, when.
Yeah,
I don't have to go back that far. But
I remember.
I remember going into bars in, because California did it first. I was out in San Diego, and I was in a bar, and there was no smoking. I'm like, wow, this is great.
Yeah.
And then going back to Pix.
Yeah.
And going in there, it was like gagging in there.
Well, in Florida, I don't know if they have outlawed it now, but like in college, I'd go down to Florida for spring break, and you could still smoke in bars.
I remember, I never smoked cigarettes. It was never my thing. I didn't have to be to read anything about it. I knew that this was not good. This is not a natural thing to do.
But it was such a political argument, though.
I was, being a car when all my friends were smoking, and probably the windows rolled up and thought nothing of it.
Yeah.
You'd stink afterwards. Yeah. But I never really saw it as a political argument. I keep, I am very politically active and whatnot. But that's really never came up on the radar.
Yeah,
I've heard about the secondhand smoke. I've read where, and I never, because I wasn't interested in it so much. Because to me, I don't like the, I just don't like the smoke either. Secondhand, third hand, I don't care. I don't want to be, I don't want to. Oh, I don't, just don't want smoke. It. Don't like it.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Have, some of that so-called science was skewed also.
Yeah, and that's basically what I'm trying to get to is like there for a long time we had this debate, and I wasn't alive at the time, but they had this debate about cigarettes being bad for you, and it became very political.
Michael Crichton wrote about that, and he wrote extensively about the DDT.
Yeah,
what a scam that was, science wise. That was all bullshit. DDT is one of the most best chemicals ever invented. And you've read how horrible it is. You know about that. You read the story of how, how that was banned.
Yeah.
Yep.
There was no science involved there.
Well, there was no.
Purely political.
No, there was science in the book. What she did was she provided the data, but the data wasn't in its pure context. So
tell me how it ends. I haven't finished.
Please. But she presented data, and it showed like graphs and stuff that showed that cancer was on the rise for children, and that as a result it was because of all the stuff they were doing. What she failed to mention though is that cancer has been that level for decades mm-hmm. before that. The reason you had the decrease in the other things is because of our increase in technology that led to our medical advances for heart disease and other kinds of. Mm-hmm. I don't know, whatever DDT, kids die remember, of.
Literally but eradicated malaria, for example.
Yeah.
In this nation, before they got rid of it. We don't have to deal with malaria, but still, another part, it could have eradicated it in Africa, too. Saved mm-hmm. millions and millions of people.
We used it during World War I.
And I'm thinking right now, I want to bring DDT back to get rid of the ticks.
Yeah. Or we could just make the temperature is colder again.
It doesn't matter. Those suckers come out at 32 degrees.
Yeah. No, it's just the nip stage.
Take the tick off of him in Westchester County. You have to take.
They've got a lot down there.
It was barely 32.
They've got a lot down there.
And they become active again right at that temperature.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess the next podcast is on DDT then.
Yeah, do my homework.
I wrote a note about that on Facebook, actually. Detailed, goes through the history of it.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, shit. Share that with me. I'll take a look at it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's up
there. And I'll have to share with you, you know, you feel free to send me anything, too.
I'll send you everything that I've looked at.
I always look at the stuff.
Yeah.
Because I do read a lot on, you know, not as much as I used to, but I still... I was looking for the one I'm going to send you about the temperature. You know, this guy, Scott Adams, that's where I first saw it. The Scott Adams Climate Challenge. I don't really know who Scott Adams is.
He's the Dilbert writer. Huh?
What is he?
The Dilbert, a creator of Dilbert.
Is he really?
Oh,
wow. Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's where I first saw it.
I know everyone's trying to dodge this question, but I'm going to ask it again.
What would I have to do to be convinced?
What would you have to see that would change your mind? Would it be time, just you don't see it over the course of your life, doesn't manifest itself, or would it be some kind of death?
No, the time thing is, again, it's a prediction, you know? So if I don't see it over the course of my life, which I personally think we're already seeing it now, so that whole argument is out the window. Like, it can't...
I would have to see some
different consensus saying 97% of climatologists on the planet.
That's your standard.
I've obviously researched this a lot too. Mm-hmm. So someone would have to show me a diagram of how they were wrong with the basic greenhouse gas diagram. Just like take that one away, say, oh, we were wrong about this and this is why, then I could start believing it. But and then someone would have to explain to me why everything else is happening. But that general diagram that's probably in a lot of biology books at this point, that would have to be changed. And once that's changed, I'll start thinking more into it. But it's too obvious at this point that industrial activity is causing global warming, among a host of other things, and environmental sort of ecocide, I guess.
Mm. So yeah. It wouldn't be any specific piece of data that maybe broke down some of the challenges.
Well, just what I was saying, the basic diagram of how greenhouse gases work.
Sure. I mean, because that I would say there is data out there. I mean, there are scientists that say that they know definitively that. It's not CO2 that drives climate, it's temperature. They think it's the opposite, really.
Well, to say that one thing... I automatically disregard anyone that says one thing drives climate.
They're saying that it's not... I mean, obviously there's other factors, but what they're saying is that the argument for the global warming theory is that CO2 increases and then temperature increases. Mm-hmm. But these guys are saying that they definitively know for fact now that it's the opposite. It's temperature goes up first, then CO2 follows behind it. Which would suggest that it's not the amount of carbon that dictates...
No, that's not true. That's not true either. Repeat what you just said one more time.
It's the exact opposite relationship that you're thinking of. The global warming theory says CO2 increases first and then temperature increases.
Yeah, that whole thing's been debunked.
No, that's what the global warming theory says.
What you're saying is people say that it's been documented that temperature goes up and then CO2 goes up.
No, I'm saying that's the global warming theory. The standard global warming theory is CO2 first, temperature second.
Okay.
There are guys that are saying they definitively know that the opposite is true, that it's temperature that rises first, and then CO2 follows temperature.
Which, yeah, that alone makes sense.
Because that defies the theory.
It doesn't defy it. It doesn't defy because you can still create balance in that system, but if temperature is rising, then the temperature of the ocean rises. And warmer ocean water releases more CO2 into the environment, and that's just science. Like if you have two cans of beer, one's ice cold and one's warm, you open the warm one, and you're gonna get a lot more fizz. You open a cold one, and you're just gonna get a little bit of bubble, and that's just science. So if temperature goes up, the temperature of the water goes up, more CO2 is released.
Now you just shot a big hole in what that's a lot yeah, of those
that's
people
a major
problem.
Not it's called not wait, all right continue
yeah well I just that's all that was my whole point
well that's the thing so if you this, just if drove the sun, big, we, you just, we,
yeah
yeah the sun drives drove, the
no I understand what's it's called non-linear climate change. So it's the same thing that's happening with permafrost. So if you look at, like, all right, we're creating more greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. We're warming the atmosphere, and therefore the ocean is warming, getting pushing more CO2 in the atmosphere with the warming of everything now. Now we're thawing out the permafrost that's in the Arctic, and that's releasing methane gas. So it's non-linear climate disruption. It's not all caused, like it's not all directly caused by human inputs. If we warm the atmosphere, or if we warm the environment ever so much, a lot of other things can happen that release the endogenous CO2 that's, or methane gas or vapor that's in the Earth's mm-hmm. system. That make sense?
No, yeah, it makes sense to me. Yeah. I'm kind of confused now, because typically the idea is that the greenhouse gases are what drive the climate. But yeah. It's obvious that we, like if you're saying the heating of the oceans, which is causing the CO2 to be released from
the ocean oceans, is the biggest yeah. repository of CO2 on the planet.
Yeah.
You know, so if you heat it and it can no longer hold all that CO2, it's going to go up. So if you're dumping CO2 or greenhouse gas into the environment, and you're creating this greenhouse effect, and you're warming the environment, you warm the ocean, well, shit, all the CO2 comes up, and then you're warming the environment, well, this permafrost is thawing and releasing methane gas. And that's what's really pushing all these terrible predictions out there, these projections that shit's going to just go completely haywire, because they really don't know what's going to happen
the shit I've been hearing for 30 years. We keep getting another 10-year extension. In fact, we just got one.
Yeah?
Is it true that we're supposed to all die in 12 years or something?
I think it's 12, yeah.
Okay. Right. So, like I
said, what was that, actually? 12 years dead. And then we die? Or?
Yeah, no, we were supposed to be dead by 1999. Yeah. Mm. Or even before that. Then we were granted the first 10-year extension. So it was supposed to be, by 2010.
Yeah.
Well, then we've got another 5-year extension now, another 5, now we just...
Well, I said it before, I think that the projections are bullshit. Like, I don't put any weight on the projections.
I guess my big problem with that I have is that, so if they're saying, okay, we're losing rainforest, we're consistently losing
rainforest. Should be gone.
We're oceans are becoming acidic.
Both measurable.
Oceans are rising and everything. At some point you would think that, If they're not, maybe the language isn't clear, but it sounds like if it's consistently increasing, there would be consequences of that, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And you would see oceans are rising, blah, blah, blah. Oh, God, we're losing parts
of... Well, it hasn't really started to affect the people that...
But you know what I'm saying? Like, you would expect to see if things are steadily increasing as bad as we think they are, and as the data that you're seeing suggests, you would think that... Unless something good was happening, unless something was slowing it down or stopping it, you would see just deforestation on a massive scale.
Deforestation isn't happening because of natural disasters. That's just man-made.
Exactly. So whatever the causes or whatever the crisis is, you would expect if nothing was being done about it, or if there's no sort of correction in any capacity, that things would be going very bad. Like acidic oceans, we touch the ocean, we start burning.
Losing coral reef.
Or coral reefs, they're all gone and they're not coming back. They're not growing back anywhere. Yeah. I mean, you would, I don't see...
If we're witnessing it happen, why do we have, I guess I don't understand, where is the argument when we're witnessing things happen?
Well, I think the idea is that it's happening on this global scale where it's like, look at the Arctic ice melting. I mean, there are people that have been telling us, at least for as long as we've been alive, the Arctic ice is melting.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's still there.
It is melting. I mean, a guy has a...
But, when is it going to be gone?
That's debatable. They show satellites there's lots of ice up there.
I remember
there's been at least two, maybe three now, expeditions called the Ship of Fools. Have you heard of Ship of Fools 1 and Ship of Fools 2? Where they went up there and got frozen in place and had to be rescued by icebreakers?
Mm.
Yeah, that's happened twice now.
I know, but for the sake of the argument, we could debate it, but I'm trying to dive into his mind a little bit and see, so if the Arctic ice is melting, and it's melting consistently, and it's, the melting is increasing, without being replenished anywhere, without some sort of good news, you would think that kind of scientifically, mathematically, you'd be able to say, if we're losing 10% of it every year because of the global warming increases, when would it be gone then? 10 years? 20 years?
It's not like it's, it melts like an ice cube in your sink.
That's the thing. We're talking about...
Think about the body of water that it empties into.
But yeah, you know, but it's like, but the idea is it's melting, it's going away, yeah, correct?
Yes.
So, and if there's a lot of voluminous good science, the science you're citing,
mm-hmm.
If it's that good, it's that solid, there's that much consensus, is it so much to ask for a little bit of predictions? Like, okay, what's going to happen this year? What's going to happen 2 years from now? What's going to happen 5 years from now? Like, is that too crazy to ask of the science?
I'm with him and I want
to see reproducible results. I want to see, like, you know, I want to look at a map, you know, from 10 years or from, you know, 20 years ago now. And I want to see, like, you know, the Arctic ice circle. And
I think that
20
you
years
can,
from now, I want to see like a big chunk of that missing. Like, I want to see the proof of it.
There is documentation of this in Greenland. I mean, I personally haven't seen it. I know it's there. Mm-hmm. So like, you can look at the glacial constitution of Greenland, like 20 years ago versus now, and you'll see a difference. Mm-hmm. So check that out. Okay. Like, I don't know what that translates to in sea level rise in Florida, but, mm-hmm. You know, I really can't even comment on that.
Okay.
I know that, like, Marco Rubio is nervous about sea level rise. Like, he doesn't deny the fact that it's mm-hmm. going to happen, but he's planning on making some sort of a buffer or something to protect.
Who's he? What does he know?
Mark, well,
I know who he is, but I mean, yeah. where, you know, what is his expertise in this area?
Well, I'm looking at someone that's pretty far right.
You know,
and
he is not far right.
See, this is the thing that drives me crazy. Yeah. This is totally over subject, but people think that, like, you know, Marco Rubio, John McCain, Mitt Romney, people think these guys are conservatives.
I know,
or far
they're
right,
not.
And it drives me so crazy because they are basically watered down Democrats. They really are. What far right person, if he's far right, if I'm a conservative and they believe in global warming, how on the right can they be? I mean, you know what I mean?
Well, there are some
conservatives that do believe in
Well, there's the new wave of conservatives, which I was telling him the other day, like Ben Shapiro, like Stephen Crowder.
They all, like, believe in global warming. They believe it's caused by his hand.
They accept it.
Yeah, they've been inundated with it their whole lives, too.
And they're just saying, what are you going to do about it?
Yeah,
you know, it's happening.
And actually, I find a lot of these people don't have any knowledge of the topic.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm sure those guys do, because their job is to research this stuff. But
they, you know, I would bet there's a lot of basic stuff that they don't know.
I'd say Ben Shapiro. I would say
Ben Shapiro's a sharp guy, really, really sharp guy.
But I think, like, I think for him specifically, I think he understands the position. But I think it's not convincing. Like, the argument, like, you know, like you said, it would have to be an overwhelming amount of information and consensus, and it'd be so much for you to even consider.
I don't like the word consensus.
Well, I'm just talking about science. But yeah,
it either is or it isn't.
We're not even talking about science at this point. We're talking about changing people's minds, which is a totally different subject.
Like, change my mind. Yeah.
Exactly. So, and I think Ben Shapiro, like, he accepts that, and I think he's like, you know what, like, I'd actually be interested to hear him say that he thinks 80%, because I want to know where he gets that from.
I can't wait to pull it up and show you.
No, I'm excited about it. But, like,
is it a recent episode?
Yeah, it is. I listened to 6 hours of Ben Shapiro when I was driving back to Texas the other day. Just to stay awake. I had to get my blood boiling a little bit.
Right on my phone, then.
Yeah. It must have been, it was somewhere in response to the Green New Deal. It was, like, right after it came out. So Green New Deal came out on, like, a Wednesday or Thursday. Mm-hmm. And I want to say that episode was on, like, a Thursday, Friday, or a Monday.
We'll pull it up.
Yeah.
But
it's not easy being green. That's on February 11th.
Yeah.
I was driving on February 11th. Mm-hmm. It could have been
maybe
February 11th.
That's the one that stands out is...
Wrote down the time of it, so...
I didn't write down the time, but I know that I can... Well, no. I paid attention to it. I know it's in there.
Okay.
I can find it.
Okay, that's all we need.
I was driving, so I couldn't write down too much.
That's all we need. But, I think so. I think his position is that, you know, let's just accept the premise, because I don't, you know, it's not convincing to people. So instead, let's talk about the solution, which I'm also interested in. I think the solution is actually where we find the most agreement, which is interesting about an argument, because it's like, you know, neither of you really agree with the presuppositions and some of the science, but I think we all actually agree with the solution, actually.
Solution to?
I mean, if we accept the premise of global warming, I mean, as an idea for the argument, I think we all agree on the solution to what the problem is. And I think, you know, and Chad said here, he doesn't, you know, he's not believing, he doesn't want more government in our life, he doesn't believe in communism or socialism, at least, correct me if I'm wrong.
I don't have a hard stance against them. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't believe in communism any more than I believe in capitalism. No. So, okay. I'm sorry. I just don't think it's a good way to organize.
Well, how about this? Do you believe in freedom, making your own decisions?
Yeah.
Economic decisions?
Yeah, big time. But
so you're, in essence, whether you know it or not, you're basically a capitalist.
Well, freedom existed long before capitalism existed. So if we, you want to talk about...
capitalism is nothing more than voluntary trade and exchange.
Okay. If that's how you define it, then that's fine. That's fine.
That's existed forever. In essence, it can be broken down to that. There's no coercion involved.
The economic market.
You can sell your labor for a price. You can own property.
And there was a lot more freedom, I guess, if we want to go back to the hunters and gatherers. A lot more freedom.
Well, sure.
A lot more freedom. Probably. So that's kind of where I'm. I know that it's not possible. Like, I'm not like an idealist in that realm, but I don't think that we have found a good system of organized, intelligent life.
Well, that's been
since
the organization of human life, in essence, has been going. That's been the goal of every utopian, as far back as you can go in history.
Mm-hmm.
You know, back to Plato's Republic. There's one that stands out in my mind where Plato.
It's really not even that far away.
What happened? Plato got so hung up in it that it took his student to tell him that you're an idiot. This is tyrannical.
Yeah,
you've come up with.
Well, he admitted later on.
Yeah,
like,
he realized
it wasn't.
He was
feasible.
Trying to come up with. You know, people have been trying to come up with a utopian society from time immemorial, basically.
Yep.
After the hunter gatherers. You know where socialism works? In a family unit.
Mm-hmm.
But not much beyond that. Because then the whole thing, you know, you've got the, you know, say, you know, the father, your father was the dictator of your household.
You don't know Barb.
Barb was the total dictator. Right. She dispensed the goods and services.
Yeah.
Right. But in essence, that it kind of worked there. It worked at that level.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
She was the benevolent dictator.
Dennis, give me your paycheck.
Yeah, right. She distributed,
the wealth around.
Right.
Yeah.
She did it at that level. But that's and probably, say, you know, our old Indian tribes at the tribal level, it probably worked pretty good too.
Yeah, and that's kind of where I usually find my mindset. I don't think about big levels anymore. They just frustrate me because we haven't seen a system that's worked on a massive level. It just doesn't.
A free market works is better than anything else.
Sure.
Deliver more goods and services to more people. You can't touch it. So far, there's nothing else out there.
Yeah, and
to bring affluence
like,
to more people, to make more people rich and prosper, you know, be prosperous. I mean, you look at how this society, how prosperous
the
society.
Standard of living. The standard of living is
huge here. You live better now than kings and queens 100 years ago.
Sure. But honestly,
we've talked about this a few times. And his argument, his opposition to capitalism isn't about what it does. It's about the unintended consequences of capitalism, which are when you substitute capitalism as instead of an economic system, as something to find meaning and purpose and fulfillment, because then you start getting into the idea of, you know, when you throw yourself into the engine of capitalism, you end up
in
this cycle of
work. In where we're at right now, when you're working 50 hours a week, it's kind of hard to not try to find meaning from all of those hours spent doing
activity. One of the correct arguments I would say against capitalism is that it is always looking to be more efficient, to make more profits, to find ways to just be and
to grow,
and all that takes a lot of time, and people are a huge part of all that, of the process of this, and people aren't like machines that can just work all day, every single day, even though we do, and a lot of people do.
Yeah, for many
generations. And obviously, well, that's the thing, like, everyone's been working so hard, and now we're at a point now where we're actually so comfortable. We're now, I mean, we have so many things at our disposals, and yet we're still so miserable and so unhappy. And this is actually where the Marxism comes in, because now you're looking at this and you're like, I'm working myself to death for probably a boss who is an asshole. And, like, what? I'm just working for this paycheck. And it's like, is that what my life is for? I'm born, I work to death, I make money, and I die? It's like, what kind of life is that? Then you hear some Marxists come along and say, oh no, like, you are being exploited, capitalism sucks, it's causing you to live in this cycle of misery. And it's like, that's why it's so enticing. That's why, like, it's so human in a sense, where it resonates with people who are not being fulfilled. But they also then are given a path that is even darker than what the one they're on.
Yeah,
now.
And I like. I just think.
But I
like,
really,
ultimately,
I
it's just like
with your
tough to find meaning in that world.
You,
I mean,
you can't find meaning in a system that's designed to make profits and losses. It's all it is. It's a
right.
It's a mechanic
and if that's
system,
the case,
you have your chance to make your profits, and you know, you've got the chance to do that.
Well, and that's one of the things of capitalism. But like people, not everyone can or will, or you know,
well, that's the thing.
There's
people
the human element because
people are not all the same.
Exactly. Some people are more ambitious than others. Some people are more willing to take risks than others. Mm-hmm. Some people, I mean, I've worked with guys who they are just so lazy, but they're also they're so envious that other people achieve stuff, and mm-hmm. it's like. But they don't do anything to. It's not like they even try to do stuff. They're just mad that someone else did it, and they think, you know, oh,
right.
I could have done that. But it's like it's very interesting, and it's like when
that's a lot of what Marxism and socialism are based on. Envy is one of
absolutely,
those
yeah, resentment and
bitterness.
A lot of more negative human emotions that cause people to. Just end up doing terrible
things. You're miserable people.
But envy is one of the primary motivators for the capitalist machine. I mean, it's a gear. Well, envy. I mean, you go to any major city, it's like, well, this person has this. I got to get this, and this.
Yeah, okay.
And that's how that's
driven. But in essence, greed. Milton Friedman, Walter Williams talk about it. Walter Williams says, I wake up greedy in the morning.
Yeah.
I mean,
he loves greed.
Greed is great.
Well, he said,
greed
is
what,
great.
In essence,
that's
he explains
it.
Greed is what makes the butcher, he gets this from one of the old-time economists that he read, makes the butcher have the cuts of meat that you want available. It's not that... It's because he likes everybody.
It's not that he cares about you, it's that he wants some damn money.
Right. He gets up and does that work, you know, because he wants the money.
Yeah.
And that's what makes the free market work.
Yeah. But I do, like, I get it. I get, well, yeah. I mean,
Milton Friedman says, is there any place in the world where they don't run on greed?
Anymore? I kind of think. Well, you can go to some hippie communes that I'm trying to get in with.
Well, and they even tried. I think they used to have the Israeli kibbutz.
You'll find greed. The pilgrims tried a socialist approach to begin with, and almost starved. And the original Thanksgiving didn't happen until after they had ditched that. And I forget the guy's name, William Bradford, when he finally assigned people their own plots of land, you know, not the communal thing, is that's when they prospered. So certain people wouldn't work.
Yeah.
And other people got sick and tired of doing the work for, you know, carrying the load for everybody. And so they didn't work much either. So there wasn't much food, but when everybody was assigned their own plot of land, had to grow their own stuff, then they had lots
surplus.
Of food.
Yeah, it's surplus.
Aside from the people that was driven off that land.
People that were what?
That was driven off
the land.
Driven. Well, no, actually, when they came there, the Indians, they were...
they were trading with them at the time.
Yeah, I that's,
the area
that's,
they settled...
It wasn't until later
what
that
happened
decided to
was
slaughter
the pilgrims all. Clearly were not the first people there. And the Indians that were... They moved right into an abandoned Indian village that most likely had gotten some disease and were died off. In fact, that's what the one guy... In fact, one of the guys... One of the Indians that is mentioned a lot in these, when you read the stories of Thanksgiving, Squanto or Samoset, something like that. One of the Indians, he spoke perfect English.
Hmm.
And you know how he spoke English?
He's been in
England.
Yeah.
So who the hell came there, brought him to England, and he managed, and then he came back. You know, so how,
that was,
how many
I think,
years have people been
I honestly there? Think that was... long after 1491. I think that was quite a bit after 1491.
15.
So like he like
people
he,
have been there long.
They've been there for
been
a long
there
time.
Long before Columbus even.
Well, Vikings people have been there. I mean,
the Vikings
Native,
were there.
Native Americans have been there.
Well, not only... And they came from where?
What's that?
Where'd they come from?
They crossed the Bering Strait.
Yeah,
yeah,
they
I
came
understand
from
that.
Asia.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can see them. They're very... Especially the northern Indians. They look very Asian.
Yeah.
They almost look oriental.
Yeah, in fact, I remember some anthropologist saying that before the Indians were there, that there were African Americans there at the time. Before them.
Well, they weren't...
Who knows?
Or whatever you would call them. There were black people there before the Indians.
See, the Indians...
I don't know what you would call the native natives.
The Indians, it was a privilege to fight for the land that they hunted on. They clearly, to them, might made right. You can go back and see where one tribe drove the other one away from a certain area. It wasn't always that the Sioux were in the Black Hills. Dakotas and whatnot.
Yeah,
no, that was fluid. We only know for a couple hundred years worth.
Yeah.
But you had the Comanche, once they learned...
The Sioux weren't originally from that area. I mean, the Sioux were driven out of the East
Coast. And the Apaches were from certain... Apaches and Comanches, and there was other tribes that they wiped out.
You could also call that a condensing of...
A hostile takeover.
Of tribal lands based on... White settlement.
This is before white settlement, even.
Well, Sioux wasn't in the Dakotas prior to white settlement. I would imagine
these tribes, and my point being, these tribes fought for resources and lands, fought with one another.
Sure.
It was not a stable like the states are today, where this is Comanche territory and this is Apache territory. No, they.
Well, that's not stable, really, either. That's not really stable.
It wasn't stable. Here you could go to sleep and not worry about in the middle of the night having savages on horseback, warriors on horsebacks, coming in and raping and pillaging and destroying, stealing all your stuff.
Yeah.
And killing you. You had to be alert to that.
Yeah. I think this is caricature of Native American Indians where they're these peace loving, these were all warrior tribes.
No, they were quite warlike.
All of them were warrior tribes. Otherwise, they wouldn't have existed.
They're probably the best cavalry ever in the world. Especially the Comanches, their horse skills are incredible.
The horses didn't exist in North America prior to colonization.
And once the Comanches were amongst the first.
I guess he's talking about came later on.
Right.
Right.
They started taming them.
That's when the Comanches became huge.
Everything that we've just touched on would postdates colonization, so we could say like the warlike attributes of these native tribes were symptomatic of colonization and what they
even
went through.
Even before that.
I understand that. Yeah, I mean, there was war.
No,
it wasn't utopia.
It didn't happen when Europeans started coming over.
I'm not saying that, but well versed in it
long before that.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would just say humans are violent creatures.
Yes,
and the Indians were no exception to this rule.
Sure.
Right. They weren't savages after, I would say...
Like, savage is pretty derogatory.
Well, would you call the Aztecs
in the world?
What's that? No, I wouldn't. Yeah.
The Aztecs? The people who were... I mean, as far as what I've read...
Savage is just not...
They were sacrificing people at altars hundreds by the day and eating their hearts and stuff.
I understand that.
There are warrior cultures
around
the world.
I would call that kind of savage, but maybe that's not correct.
Yeah. I mean, the white people that settled in Indian lands were pretty savage to Indian.
Oh, sure.
Well, compared to European culture,
yeah.
You could say that. I'm not saying that. I mean, to me, I have great respect for how they lived, how they were in tune with the land and whatnot.
Yeah.
That's something that's absolutely totally lost.
That's kind of where it's funny. Before this, I had a 2-hour discussion with a local group about deep adaptation in response to global climate catastrophe and systems breakdown. This is like the precursor to this conversation. So,
I think we'd all agree on that. I think being more self-sufficient, more self-sustaining.
I was thinking about that on the way up. I was like, ultimately, if shit does break down, like, what do you mean? If society breaks down, like, I think that we're all going to find pretty good synergies in self-sufficiency, the three of us. We'll still argue about why that happened, but
no, we're on to listen.
I'll guarantee you, there's a lot of people in your generation, a bit younger, that think milk comes from the grocery store.
Yeah, yeah. God, yeah, it's pretty awful.
You know, meat comes. Yeah, you buy meat in the grocery store. It's just there. It's done. You know, they have no idea actually cutting up a deer.
Yeah.
They'd be horrified. Mm-hmm. They'd starve to death, probably.
Yeah, yeah. When I was in Austin, I had 4 chickens in my backyard, mm-hmm. and I just, like, I had been detached from the hunting world for so long that I was like, I gotta go kill one of these chickens, because, like, I just gotta do it.
I'm getting too soft.
Yeah, and just, like, I'm living with two people at the time that just, like, chicken comes from little packets. Plastic packages with styrofoam in the back, and I'm just like, I gotta do it.
Let me show you what chickens look like.
Yeah, so I butchered one of my chickens in the backyard.
They flee in all directions? Call the
police? They weren't home, but they're just like, dude, I'm so glad we weren't home for that. Like, yeah. I gotta get going, though.
Yeah,
well, okay,
we're gonna have to condense this one.
You answer the question. What about you? Final question, what would it take to change your mind about global warming?
No, I thought I told you.
Did you? Did I miss it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I want to see it warming up. I want to see this thing not be political. I want to see real scientific debates on the subject. Mm-hmm. That's in essence to me is make it not a political issue.
So no politicians.
Let's see that it's really warming.
Data results. Observations.
Real data, not tampered data.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Agreeable data.
Right. And if it is raw, unfiltered, unchanged data, all the scientists would concur on that.
We probably wouldn't be able to read it, really.
Well, they could explain
simple like temperature things.
Yeah, okay.
And if you're going to insist that we change what we do, first of all, you wouldn't think that people that, you know, these people that say we should stop flying jets, well, you'd think if they were so concerned that they wouldn't be flying jets, right? Private jets, for example.
That's one of the things.
You know, then.
You're talking about Al Gore?
Well, it's just one. You can name any. Yeah. DiCaprio, who's a.
Well,
you know, all
these
did
a carbon offset, of course.
We just, yeah. It tells me that these are not serious people. But this whole. The whole political thing, it would have, you know, have to go, and because socialism is not the answer.
Sure, I'm fine with that.
Agree. And another thing I'll say, a little bit of warming is not a bad thing.
I'm actually pro global. I'm pro global.
You know what I say? Bring it on.
I don't believe in it, but I'm very pro.
I'm not going to get down into that one.
I would go back to the medieval warming period, also known as the little climactic optimum.
Hmm.
Where the population, you know, I guess you think there's enough people already, but during that time frame, the population
too much.
You're
wrong. Yeah.
At least doubled during that time,
and they all died.
A lot of good beer was formed. That stuff would grow. A lot of good beer and wine was.
A lot more. There's gonna be a lot more ticks if we have a little bit more.
Need chickens to eat them.
A lot more ticks.
You have to get chickens.
Just have to kill off all the deer.
I just think that, have you noticed in your time that every couple of years is like a certain animal or something that or large numbers of, like we've seen chipmunks lately, huge chipmunks everywhere. The cat kills 2 or 3 a day, and they keep coming.
Well, that's just dictated by oak mast.
One year it was raccoons, and turkeys have been flourishing since the bunch of the raccoons died off from rabies and whatnot.
Yeah.
Turkey population became huge. There's really no hunters anymore, other than the locals. But we used to be inundated with hunters even in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
There was Margaretville was full of people. You used to see them up in Dalhousie as much, but really down Margaretville, Andes.
When I was cutting deer, that's all we had 400 long
out seasons. Where you would just.
It doesn't seem to be that many hunters anymore. It's the deer all over the place.
Yeah, and that's probably one of the reasons for the ticks, too.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thanks so much, guys. We'll have to do it again. Maybe that's on a different subject. capitalism. Or maybe we'll just do that and throw in some of our, Indian culture.
We'll just have to have like a...
Survival stuff. That'd be interesting.
Yeah, we can do the post-collapse.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. All right. See you guys later.
Later!